Okay. Second type of hydride to write down. That is second type of hydride. Metallic hydride, which we also call it as non-stoichiometric. Metallic non-stoichiometric, or we also call it as interstitial hydrides. Write down these type of hydrides. These are just informations, okay? This type of hydrides are formed by adsorption of hydrogen on the metal lattice. This is adsorption, not absorption. Okay, remember that. On metal lattice, it is mostly formed by transition element. Transition element. Last point, and the properties of these hydrides are similar to that of parent metal. Okay, see here, these hydrides are non-stoichiometric. Right, for example, you see it forms YH2 type, YH3 type, LaH2.87, VS0.56, etc. VH2 also it forms. Okay, non-stoichiometric hydrides. Density of these hydrides are is lesser than from the parent metal. Done, copy. Yeah, one very important property we have here, write down this question, they ask many times in the exam. If you see from group 6, 7, 8, and 9, in these four groups of transition element, only one element we have which forms this type of hydrides, that is chromium. From group this, only chromium forms this type of hydrides, this type of hydrides, and hence from group 6 to group 9, this we call it as hydride gap. See, in this hydride, what happens? The hydrogen, it includes into the crystal lattice. So its volume expands. When hydrogen includes, so in the previous one, it does not affect the, you know, the crystal structure. But here the volume, the crystal expands, volume increases. Okay. Right. So when hydrogen goes into the interstices of the metals, right, so its volume increases because the lattice expands and hence overall density decreases. That's the reason we have. Yeah. Last one you write down. Third type. That is molecular hydrides. Molecular hydrides and covalent hydrides are the same thing, molecular or covalent. Like I said, it is formed by the P block elements, right? Along with that, beryllium and magnesium also forms, okay? Formed by P block elements, and along with P block we have example of BeH2 and MgH2, covalent hydride forms. These hydrides are covalent in nature because the electron negativity difference is not that great, right? In some molecule like HF, we have great electronegativity difference, but there we have a small size. So more polarization leads to covalent character there. Right? Like I said, further, this hydrides are classified into three categories. First one is electron deficient. Electron deficient hydrides are those hydrides in which the number of electrons is less than 8. For example, first of all, you see it is formed by the elements of group 13. In P block, first is elements of group 13. So the hydrides that we have BH3, AlH3, etc. So if you look at the electrons for boron in this compound, BH3, the electron we have for boron is 6 electron, less than 8. So it is electron deficient. Right, it contains one vacant orbital here. If you look at the bonding, vacant orbital, and hence it has tendency to accept electron. Right, it can accept electron pair. So it has tendency to accept electron pair. Hence it behaves as Lewis acid. Done. Okay. Next, write down the second type in this. We have B. That is electron precise hydrides. Electron precise means which has exactly 8 electrons. For example, you see it is formed by which group? Could you tell me? By the elements of group. Any idea? Group 14, not 2, it's group 14. Group 2 is the alkali metals, so alkaline earth metals. So group 14. Okay. So example of this, if you see, we have CH4, SiH4, etc. All these molecules you see, carbon has exactly 8 electrons, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Right, 8 electrons, it is electron precise hydrides. What is the hybridization? What is the geometry? Geometry, shape, same, because there is no lone pair, correct? Similarly, the third type we have, that is electron rich. Electron rich hydrides are those which contains lone pair. Which has tendency to donate electron pair. So we must have lone pair for this. It is formed by the elements of group 15 to 17. Group 15 also forms. Group 16 also forms. And group 17 also forms. Group 15, the example you see, NH3 has one lone pair. Group 16 has H2O has two lone pair. And group 17, we have HF, 3 lone pairs. So all these hydrides contains lone pairs and calls electron rich hydrides. Since electron pair is present here, lone pair, so it has tendency to donate lone pair and hence it behaves as Lewis base. Thank you. Done. Okay, so next the hydrides we are done. Next we'll see the another type of compounds we have, that is hydrogen peroxide. What is the formula of hydrogen peroxide? H2O2. Okay, first of all we'll see the preparation of it. How do we prepare hydrogen peroxide? Just one, two methods we have, not much. Preparation, write down. From barium peroxide. Write down hydrated barium peroxide. Hydrated barium peroxide. The formula is BaO2 dot 8H2O. Hydrated barium peroxide reacts with dilute H2SO4 to form hydrogen peroxide. Okay, so the reaction is BaO2 dot 8H2O. These reactions, basically you have to, methods, it's not important, but there's no logic into this. You have to memorize this. Okay, however they won't ask these questions. H2SO4 dilute gives BaSO4 plus H2O2 plus 8H2. This is a reaction we get. One note you write down, anhydrous, copy down this first. Write down anhydrous barium peroxide. Anhydrous barium peroxide forms a protective layer of barium sulfate Anhydrous barium peroxide forms a protective layer of barium sulfate on reaction with H2SO4 and does not allow the reaction to proceed. Okay. Okay, so if you use anhydrous barium peroxide with on reaction with H2SO4, it will create a layer of barium sulfate on its surface, which prevents the further reaction. And hence H2O2 does not form. That's why we do not use anhydrous form, but we use hydrated form of barium peroxide. So I'm repeating itself. Anhydrous barium peroxide forms a protective layer of barium sulfate on reaction with H2SO4 and prevents the further reaction. Okay. The second method of preparation we have, that is electrolytic process. Electrolytic process. Right on. In this method, electrolysis of of 50% H2SO4, sulfuric acid, is carried out at low temperature using platinum electrode. So you have 2H2SO4, which ionizes and forms 2H SO4 minus, and this further oxidizes. I'll write down it separately, wait. This further oxidizes 2HSO4 minus, oxidize into H2S2O8, and the electron comes out. This reaction takes place at anode. In the next step, hydrolysis of H2S2O8. H2S2O8 goes under hydrolysis in the next step and forms H2SO4 and hydrogen peroxide. Yeah, done. Okay, so these are the preparation method, two preparation method of hydrogen peroxide. But questions they do not ask on the preparation method. Only one point is important, that why we use why we use hydrated barium peroxide to prepare hydrogen peroxide. H2S2O8 is peroxysulfuric acid. H2S2O8, if you want to see the structure, six, huh? The structure is this: S double bond O we have, and we have double bond O, OH. O, O. Peroxy disulfuric acid. It has a peroxy linkage here. Okay. Could you tell me the oxidation state of sulfur here and here? Oxidation state, I asked. Advik. Yes, oxidation state is plus 6 on both sulfur atom. Have discussed these things, no? In redox, it's not minus, it's plus 6. Yeah, no doubt in this? Correct. Now, so preparation method, like I said, only that why barium, hydrated barium peroxide we are using for the preparation, that reason you must remember. And one thing that you must keep in mind is the structure of H2O2. H2O2 is, we call it as open book structure. It has open book structure. Open book structure is this. We have oxygen-oxygen bond, and this hydrogen is connected like this. So you imagine this is the spine of the book, OO bond, spine of the book, correct? And one side is this open, and other side is this open. Like one page is this side, one page is this side. Open book structure. Each oxygen atom has two lone pair. Okay. The bond angle here, this bond angle equals to this bond angle, both are 97 degree. This bond length is L1, and the bond length here, OO bond length is L2. This bond length here is also L1. So bond length of L2 is greater than L1. This you must remember. The name of the structure plus this relation. Why? Because we have lone pair present here. So we'll have lone pair repulsion. That's why the bond length here increases. Yes, yes, yes. It is important. The bond length L2, this is not important to memorize. L2, the OO bond length we have, it is 1.48 angstrom, and the OH bond length L1 is 0.97 angstrom. Right? So because of lone pair repulsion, OO bond length is more than to that of OH bond length. Okay. So if you look at this orbital diagram, of H2O2. Oxygen has 8 electron. One second, I'll go back. What is the hybridization of oxygen? Could you tell me? What is the hybridization of oxygen in H2O2? SP3, correct. So 1s, here you see, 1s and 3p will go under hybridization and it forms 4 sp3 hybridized orbital like this, in which 2 orbital has 2 electron and 1 orbital has, and 2 orbital has 1 electron. All these are sp3 hybridized orbital, correct? And similarly, we have this for the another oxygen atom also. So if you draw this orbital, see this, one orbital is this, another orbital is this. Okay, I'm assuming this two orbital has two electron, two lone pair. This one has one electron and this one also has one electron. This I have just represented this way in the orbital form. If you talk about the another oxygen atom, which is this, this also has four sp3 hybridized orbital. Okay. Two electron, one electron, and one electron like this. So what is this axis? Internuclear axis forms a sigma bond, axial overlapping, yes or no? Axial overlapping. So this is how the oxygen-oxygen sigma bond forms. And you must remember this, in this sigma bond, sp3-sp3 orbital overlaps and forms a sigma bond. These two bonds are attached with hydrogen. So you see hydrogen is this. Hydrogen with s orbital, with one electron it comes and overlap with this orbital. This is the one electron of it. This forms again a sigma bond. So this is OH bond, O bond, OH bond. This is what the bonding we have. So here we have sp3 s overlap, sp3 s overlap, sp3 sp3 overlap. Done. Thank you. Yeah. Now, a few properties of hydrogen peroxide, you write down. First one, it is colorless and odorless. It is colorless, odorless, and bitter in taste. Colorless, odorless, and tasteless. Sorry, bitter in taste, not tasteless. No. No, Madhav. Then you'll ask me, how do we know that it is bitter in taste? Right? Yes, I knew that. When you try to find out the property of these compounds, so we'll do some experiment. We obviously you need to only test it. You can do that for testing only, but you don't eat it, like it's not edible. Correct. Okay, so colorless, odorless, bitter in taste, right? It is known as associated molecule due to hydrogen bonding. It is known as associated molecule due to hydrogen bonding. Okay. Like wherever we have hydrogen bonding, the molecule is said to be associated molecule because one molecule is connected with others, like in water molecule also, NH3 also, HF also, correct? So this is also associated molecule. And all those molecules which can form hydrogen bonding with water are soluble in water, correct? So this one is also soluble in water. No, it's not. Nothing is written now. Okay? Right? It is soluble in water. I'll write down. Since it forms hydrogen bonding, so it is soluble in water. Even we can also say alcohol because alcohol can also show hydrogen bonding with H2H2. And ether. Right? It is a powerful oxidizing agent. It is a powerful oxidizing agent. So if you look at the reaction here, it is lead sulfide PbS plus H2O2. It oxidizes lead into sulfate PbSO4 and get itself reduced. If you see this reaction, hydrogen sulfide with H2O2, it converts into H2O plus sulfur. Okay, next write down. In this only, I'll write down one more point. It is also, we'll talk about it. One second, Namta. It is also a reducing agent, we'll talk about it. Just a second. Due to its, due to its oxidizing nature it acts as a bleaching agent, decolorizes any colored material. It produces a nascent oxygen, and in presence of nascent oxygen, this colored material becomes colorless. So this we call it as the bleaching action. So bleaching action is the conversion of color pigments into colorless thing, right? That is the bleaching action. Decolorizes. This property is important. Oxidizing agent, bleaching action. Direct question you will get. Okay, it's a powerful oxidizing agent. We have seen that. It shows oxidizing nature. Along with oxidizing nature, it also behaves as reducing agent. So next line you write down. Reducing agent. It is also a strong reducing agent. Strong reducing agent. Like suppose we have silver oxide, Ag2O, reacts with H2O2. It reduces silver into silver metal plus H2O, and oxygen evolves. Yeah, one second, I'll go back. Okay, so wherever it shows reducing action, it always releases oxygen gas, right? When they ask you some questions in a school exam and all, so you have to write down the answer, all this, and you have to support your answer with some examples, like any reactions like this. Like, could you tell me what is the oxidation state of silver here? In this compound, oxide. How it is plus 4, Pranav? Yeah, it's plus 1, correct? So minus 2, and this is plus 1. Yeah. What is this? 0, because we have independent element, 0. So plus 1 to 0, what is this? Oxidation state decreases. So it is reducing, it is getting reduced. So it is a reducing behavior of it. This reaction is important. Chlorine, when reacts with H2O2, it converts into HCl and oxygen gas evolves. So in all these reducing behavior, we have oxygen gas comes out. The oxygen is a part of H2O2 only, na? So H2O2 will reduce chlorine and oxidize itself. So oxygen will get oxidized. That's what the thing is. Both won't get reduced, no? H2O2, oxygen is a part of hydrogen peroxide initially. So it oxidizes, it reduces chlorine and get itself oxidized. Fine only. Ag2O also, silver will get reduced, and this minus 1 converts into minus 2 and 0. H2O2 also have the property of showing disproportionation reaction. That was the next point I was about to talk. Okay, it have the tendency to goes under auto oxidation reduction. That is disproportionation reaction. So here what is happening, that's a different thing, but this one is reducing silver. So it is a reducing agent. Okay. Write down next point. It is unstable in nature. It is unstable in nature and goes under disproportionation reaction. That is auto oxidation reduction. 2H2O2 converts into 2H2O and O2. 0, minus 2, minus 1. Auto oxidation reduction. And the last reaction for this, you write down, last property, is the acidic nature. Anurag, we have discussed this thing in redox, that if you have peroxide, in peroxide, the oxidation state of oxygen is minus one, if you remember that. O, O, O. So minus one, plus one, plus one. This is the structure we have. What zero? I didn't get you. Yeah, here it is minus one, here it is minus two and zero. Yeah, so oxygen is minus one. I'm talking about oxygen here. So oxygen is getting reduced and oxidized. Correct. Yeah. In water, we won't have, it will, you know, decompose into the ionic form a little bit, not much. We don't have traces of peroxide in water. Acidic nature, you see. It reacts with alkali solution. It reacts with alkali solution and give corresponding peroxides. Like for example, just two example here, H2O2, suppose reacts with NaOH, it forms corresponding peroxide. So Na2O2 and H2O, 2H2O. It reacts with, suppose, Na2CO3. Again, it forms Na2O2 plus H2CO3, which decomposes further into H2O and CO2. This is the acidic behavior. Acidic behavior, you can understand, it is base. Base reacts with one compound, giving water. So it is base acid, acid-base reaction. Clear, understood? Okay, fine. So we are left with one last thing in this chapter, that is the water molecule, hardness of water and all. We'll discuss this after the break, correct? So heading you write down, water, H2O. We'll discuss this after the break. Correct. We'll resume the session at 6:20. Sorry, 6:30. Take a break now. Yeah, I know. I'll just put it in the charge. Okay, take a break, guys.